Henrietta Seiberling, speaking to her son John Seiberling in 1971, the lady who introduced Dr. Bob to Bill Wilson back in 1935, which later became Alcoholics Anonymous.
What did Bob read?
Well, what I would say is, I would say that you would, if I were you, I would say that you would like very much to speak of some of the, of something of Bob and his humility, and but I don't know, I had it all kind of organized, but now I'm so disorganized this time of day and so tired. I've been waiting around for Dottie to go to dinner. How long are you going to be at your office?
Not very long.
And then you're going home?
Yeah, well, I'll be here a half an hour, probably.
Well, I was thinking maybe you could start in your speech by saying that that a few years ago at a the big dinner here in New York at the Americana Hotel, they persuaded your mother to say something, and so she came up on the platform at the dais and said, now this is if you want the tape on this.
Yeah, okay.
You got the tape.
Yeah, but this is just for my edification.
Yes, I said.
Go ahead.
And I said, it is awe-inspiring to see so many people here, all knowing all their lives are all turned towards God, and to know that they are all over the world letting God direct their lives.
Mm-hmm.
Now that's what I said. And I don't know, there's so much that I want to say. And we better turn it off, John, because I just...
Well, just go ahead and tell me.
Well,
you're not making a speech, you're just telling me something.
I had a lot written out, but, oh yes, I know what it is. At that dinner, you could say, you got it now.
Yeah.
There was Father Dowling, a Jesuit priest, who had first met our group in the early days in Chicago, and he came to Akron to see us. And then he went on to New York to see the others in the early days. And he said to one of our men, this is one of the most beautiful things that has come into the world, and I want to warn you, the devil will destroy it, try to destroy it. And, of course, it was true. And one of the first things that the devil could have used was having money and having sanitariums, as the men were planning. And much to Bob and Bill and Anne and surprise, I said, no, we'll never take any money. And another thing where...
When did Father Dowling say this?
Father, no, I said that, we'll never take any money.
Yeah, but I mean, when did Father Dowling say that?
Father Dowling, in the early days, he...
Yeah.
Where was he
from? Akron?
He was a Jesuit priest, no. He was in Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
And he's one of the first ones that took notice of us. And at this dinner where I said to them about being awe-inspiring to see all these people living, I would say, splendid lives, all turned towards God. Father Dowling was there at this dinner maybe 25 years later.
Mm-hmm.
But he was a Jesuit priest. And there was something, oh yes. And then another place where I saw that the devil could try to destroy us was having prominent names. And now last night, this is between you and me, last night I heard Harold Hughes on a special program for alcoholism.
Yeah.
And they asked him, his explanation of why they're anonymous was it showed that he really never had known why we became anonymous. He said, well, it wouldn't do to let people know that you were alcoholic. Well, that is not the reason. In fact, the surest way to stay sober is to let people know you're alcoholic, because you've lost some of yourself. I would say the second thing that your mother saw, that the devil would be trying to destroy us, was to have any name, because people that think they're prominent or become leaders are failed people. Oh, no one is on top spiritually all the time.
Mm-hmm.
So I said, we'll never have any name. Now, one thing you can stress, that your mother she feels now that the whole wonderful experience of Alcoholics Anonymous growing, it came in answer to the great need in the world. And she is confident that this combination of Bill. Now, you can say Bill, my mother told Bill that he was a promoter and he was the catalyst. And we needed him as, by nature, a promoter. Bob was kept his great humility, and if you spoke to him about his work, he'd say, oh, I just work here.
Mm-hmm.
And Bob was really the firm and wonderful worker. And then Anne she supplied a home in his for our men in the beginning. And Mother tried to give to the people something of her experience and faith. And what she's most concerned with is that we always go back to faith. And the third thing that would be destructive was early days, Bob and Bill said to me, Henrietta, I don't think we'd better talk too much about religion or God, because I told this once to a group of a meeting of alcoholics, and they were very amused. And it's good to put in a little humor. And I said, well, we're not out to please the alcoholics. They've been pleasing themselves all these years. We are out to please God. And if you don't talk about what God does and your faith and your guidance, you might as well be the Rotary Club or something, because that's your only source of power. And finally they agreed, and they weren't afraid anymore. And it's my great hope that they'll always bring coming out, never be afraid to acknowledge God and what he's done for you. And then I would say, the last meeting I went, dinner that I went to, over 3,000 people there. And it's the first meeting I ever went to I was disappointed in. The two witnesses, man and woman, they talked on, and you would have thought that they were giving you a description of a psychiatrist's work on them. Their progress was always on the level of psychology. And I spoke to Bill afterwards, and I said that there was no spirituality there, a talk of what God had done in their lives. In fact, they were giving views and not news of what God had done. And Bill said, well, I know, but they think that there's so many people that need this, and they don't want to send them away. So there again has come up this same old bugaboo and not the realization that they have lost, you know, their source of power. And it reminded me, if you like this little story, your mother said it made her think of this young Scotch minister who was to go and preach his first sermon, and his mother hugged him. Didn't she kiss? But she hugged him and said, "Now, Bobby, don't forget to say a word for Jesus." I think I'd tell him that. And say, your brother always wants to say a word for God. That is very good. I think, you know, little touches of humor like that. There was so much I wanted to tell you, but at this time of day, I'm all in the heat and everything. It's just really, I wrote a lot out. But those are the three things that your mother stood on guard and guard, it's G-U-A-R-D. And then there's one thing I would always like to stress on to them, the real facts of real guidance. They can always count on guidance, although it seems elusive at times. I would like, if I had time, I would like to tell about Bob at the beginning. And maybe you have a moment here, I can say it.
Yeah.
Tell about it. Well, Bob and Anne came into the Oxford group, which, as you know, was the movement to try to recapture the power of faith-centered Christianity in the modern world, and a quality of life, which we must always emphasize. And someone spoke to me about Bob Smith's drinking, and because he didn't think people knew it. So I decided the people that shared in the Oxford group had never shared very costly things to make Bob lose his pride and share what he thought would cost him a great deal. So I decided to gather together some Oxford group people for a meeting, and that was in T. Henry Williams' house. And we met afterwards for about, I don't know how many years, 5 or 6 years after that, every Wednesday night. But that's mere incidental. But I warned Anne that I was going to have this meeting, and I didn't tell her why, it's for Bob, but I said, come prepared to mean business. There's going to be no pussyfooting around. And so we did all share very deeply our shortcomings and what we'd had victory over. And then it was silence, and I waited. And I thought, will Bob say anything? And sure enough, he said, well, in this deep, serious tone of his, have you good people have shared things that I'm sure very costly to you. And I'm going to tell you something that may cost me, may cost me my profession, that was it. And alcoholics always laugh. And he said, I'm a silent drinker. And I can't stop. The first we ever knew about it, Bill was not there. Weeks before Bill ever came. And so we said, well, do you want us to pray for you? And he said, yes. We said, then somebody said, do you want to go down on your knees and pray for you? And he said, yes. So we did. And the next morning, I, who knew nothing about alcoholism, thought a person should drink like a gentleman, and that's all. I was saying prayer for Bob because I said, oh, God, I don't know anything about drinking, and I told this man, then I'm sure if he lives this way, he could quit drinking. Now you have to help me. And something said to me, and I call it guidance, it was like a voice in top of my head, and said, Bob mustn't not touch one drop of alcohol. And I knew that wasn't my thought. So I called Bob and said I'd had guidance for him, and this is very important. And he came over at 10 o'clock in the morning, and I told him that my guidance was he mustn't touch one drop of alcohol. And he was very disappointed because guidance would mean, he thought, you know, see somebody or go someplace. And then this is something very relevant. And he said, Henrietta, I don't understand it. Nobody understands it. Now, that's the state of the world of... Well, when I was beginning, and he said, some doctor has written a book about it, but he doesn't understand it. I don't like the stuff. I don't want to drink. And I said, well, Bob, that's what I've been guided about. And that was the beginning of our meetings, long before Bill ever came. And I do remember, and this may interest them, and you can call it some of your mother's reminiscence, because I remember his very words. Bill, it's detailed, and he probably he never wrote it out. But when he was down to a few dollars in a hotel and owed his bill for this business adventure that fell through, he told me... He was tempted, he looked at the cocktail room and he thought, well, I'll just go in there and get drunk and then, you know, forget it all. And that would be the end. And having been sober 5 months in the Oxford group, he said a prayer instead. And he said he got the guidance to look at a minister's directory. And a strange thing happened. He just looked down there and he put his finger on one name, Tunks. And he said, I'll take that one. And that was no coincidence, a strange thing, because Dr. Tunks, and this is a chain of success, was Mr. Firestone's minister, and Mr. Firestone had brought 60 of the Oxford group people down there for 10 days out of gratitude for those people helping his son who drank too much. And his son had quit for a year and a half or so. And that is a very interesting thing, that out of the act of gratitude of one father, this whole chain started. Well, so he called Tunks, Dr. Tunks. And Dr. Tunks gave him a list of names. And one of them was Norman Shepherd, who was a close friend of mine and knew what I was trying to do for Bob Smith at these meetings. And Norman said, I have to go to New York tonight, but you call Henrietta Seiberling. I didn't know Dr. Tuck, so Bill just shortened everything by saying he called Dr. Tuck. And he said, you call Henrietta Seiberling. So Bill said he had his last nickel. And he thought, well, I'll call her. He had called many Oxford group people, among them the little Presbyterian minister, J.C. Wright, who was too busy writing his Sunday sermon on a Saturday afternoon to see him, and we had been told that people come before saints. Put everything aside for a person. But he didn't do it, and he missed a great chance. So I, who was desperate to help Bob for something I didn't know much about, was ready. And Bill called, and I'll never forget what he said. He said, "I'm from the Oxford group, and I'm a rum hound." Those were his words. And I thought, well, this is really better from heaven. And I said, "Well, you come right out here." And my thought was to put those two men together. And Bill, you know, he, now as he looked back, he thought he was out to help somebody. He was out to get help from, right for himself. No other thought of anybody because he was desperate. But that's the way God helps us out, if we let God direct our lives. And so he came out and he stayed at dinner, and then I said, "Well, you come to church meeting in the morning, Sunday morning, and I'll get Bob," which I did. That was the beginning, and Bill stayed on with us, and he didn't have any money to stay on. And there was a neighbor, John Gamatus, who had been to see a change in my life, and he was really a diamond in the rough, but he was interested in the change in me. And so I called him up and asked him to put Bill up at the country club for 2 weeks or so to just keep him in town. And then Bill went and stayed at Bob and Ann's for 3 months. And we started working on, well, the first one we had was Bill Dodson and Ernie Galbraith. Well, anyway, the need was there. And then all of the necessary elements were furnished by God. Bill, the promoter for the work, and I to stand there and not being an alcoholic and could get a perspective. And for the time being, Father Dowling said, I kept the devil away as much as I could. And every Wednesday night, I would speak on some new experience or new spiritual idea I had read or something. And that's the way we all grew, and then we all talked. And our meeting, some man from Hollywood came there, an actor, and he said he'd been all over the country. There was something in the King School group, which this group eventually turned out to be. There's something in this group that isn't any in any other group, and I think it was our great stress and reliance on guidance and quiet time. And I'd like to tell about how the 24-hour day program, that sentence, you know, live the 24-hour day, came about. Do you remember Bill Dodson, Joe Doppler? You remember?
I remember Bill Dodson.
Well, in the early days, we sat around in a circle at Clary's and T. Henry's house. And I see there the house was divided. And it was a strange thing because Clarice Williams and T. Henry, they were not in any way my type of people, but she always was in our group. She pursued me. She always wanted me to come to her house or to go with her to places for the group, and that was meant to be, because I never, personally, we never would have been drawn to each other, but there, you see, there was a house to be provided.
Well, let me ask you something. My recollection was that Tunks referred Bill to Grandmother Seiberling.
No, to Norman Shepherd.
Grandmother
Seiberling had nothing to do with it.
But then didn't Norman or someone refer him to Grandmother Seiberling, and by mistake he called you?
No. He said, no. He said in his book, in the book, that he was loath to call a Mrs. Seiberling because he'd heard of Mr. Seiberling in Wall Street, but he pictured a middle-aged a lady, you know, and he was reluctant, but he was desperate, and he tells that in the book. Now, I would say, Bill, that I would say you want to pay tribute to Bill. I would start that way, that he did a great, grand job, and that we can all see in his life what the Oxford Group people had told us in their first, in their message, that if we turn our lives to God and let him run it, that he will take our very shortcomings and make them valuable in his way and give us our heart's desires. And when I got the word that Bill had gone on, I sat here, this is between you and me, and it's just as if somebody had spoken again on top of my head. The way I got guidance about it, someone said to me, "Verily, verily, he has received his reward." And he kept coming to me, So I went to the Bible, and there it was in I think it's Matthew 6 chapter. And then I took Bill's story from Alcoholics Anonymous. I took the book down, and there I saw where he said all his failure and all the different things he failed in was because he always wanted people to think he was somebody. And in the first edition of the book, he said, "I always wanted to make my mark among people." And by letting God run his life, God took that ego and gave him his heart's desires, but in God's way. And when he was God, he was on the front pages of the New York Times. And he was services all over the world. So it does verify what the Oxford Group people had told us. And there's so many things I want to say. But then I would say that when Bill was writing Alcoholics Comes of Age, he asked me to read the first draft because he didn't remember all the early past. And, well, you don't need to put that in, it's too long. But
go ahead. I wanted to ask you this statement of Bill's about how this whole thing came to him while he's lying in the hospital recovering from his alcoholism, and he had a vision.
Well,
that's a lot of hokum, isn't it?
No, I wouldn't.
I'm not going to say that, isn't that a fact?
Well, he may have had it, but the most...
Well, he didn't think this whole thing up himself.
No, of course, but that's all right. You see, it was his ego. His ego would have...
Never even occurred to him until after he'd had all these meetings.
I know, but let me tell you, would please the people. Bill's account, when he first came to Akron, his account with his friend, who went into Oxford Group, his friend persuaded him. You remember his friend's name?
No.
Well, it's in the book, but I can't think of it now.
Doesn't matter.
Anyway, his friend persuaded him, when he saw his friend change, to go down to an Oxford Group meeting. It was down in the lower part, maybe down 25th Street or somewhere along there.
Calvary Church.
No, it wasn't. It was just a meeting down in the lower Manhattan. And Bill said, this is the miracle. Every bar on each side of the street, till he got to this little meeting, and he walked, and in the meantime, he picked up a drunken sailor with him. and he and the drunken sailor walked in.
You're...